Ernest Peter Uiberall, and you were telling me about some of the trials and the subsequent proceedings, and you mentioned that you were involved in trial number three.
Right, I interpreted in trial number three.
Were you involved with any of the other trials?
Not directly, but indirectly, yes, because I was at the same time a staff officer in the translation division, or language division as it was then called, and when problems came up, I had to help with it. We had sometimes as many as five courts running at the same time. There were six courtrooms set up, never all six courtrooms in use. We didn't even have personnel enough to do that, but we did have, for some days, we had five courtrooms simultaneously working.
How much turnover was there among translators and interpreters in these trials?
It's hard to tell because the people who came from the United States, for instance, came on a government contract, which required them to be, it wouldn't pay to send them overseas for less than a year, I would think. And therefore, they were there at least a year, sometimes another year. Others came from Switzerland, for instance, where they were also engaged for a year and very seldom extended. Here and there they did. I set up, for instance, among other things that I had to do as a staff officer, set up a document registry, which was absolutely necessary for all these thousands of documents. We did, in the translation branch, written translations, we did about a volume of 5,000 pages a week that had to be kept track of. And we had a very, very good Swiss gentleman who came to be a translator, flunked the translation test, but knew enough as a Swiss tourist industry man, knew enough of the languages to be able to handle the document registry, and he did a very good job as a registry clerk. That's one of the things that I had to do throughout the subsequent proceedings. Sometimes people were not in the right places, and I had access to the director, and then later became acting director myself, and was able to make changes as necessary or as desired.
What was your wife doing while you were working in Nuremberg?
She was working for the prosecution. She was the executive secretary to the deputy chief prosecutor, Drexel Sprecher, at the time.
While you two were in Europe, did you both or either one of you try to find family and friends at you'd left behind when you came to the States?
No. My parents were in the States. My brother was in the States. Cousins, uncles, aunts. Either in the States or a part of the family was in Colombia.
What happened to your wife's stepfather?
Theresienstein. He died then.
What was it like for you to be living with Germans who had allowed Hitler to...
We didn't live with them. We were in an island, an American occupation island. There were no... Well, in the house that the colonel had set up, there were Germans working, maids, housekeeper, a cook, but that's all. We had very little contact with Germans at the time.
What did you do in your time off?
What time off? Hardly. Later on, we were able here and there on a Sunday to go out into the neighborhood on a jeep. And we met at the house with friends that came to visit in the evening sometimes. But there was, for the language people, there was very little time off. The lawyers had more time off. The lawyers had parties to which we were not invited. And one time I was invited because Drex Sprecher became a friend of mine to a party in his quarters, and there was the presiding judge and Telford Taylor, general then, brigadier general, and I played the something polka, and they both danced the polka. I fooled around on the piano, so I had great fun that evening. But that was a rare occasion.
While you were working in the trials, did you have a chance to see Vienna at all?
Yes. At the end of the first trial, after the first trial, my boss, Commander Steer, said that if I wanted to try and get stationed in Austria, which was, of course, the country where I'd grown up, that would be possible, that I could go down to Austria and check in at some American outfits and see if they would like to have me stationed there. So he laid on a trip, a temporary duty trip, TDY trip, and I went to Linz, where I talked to an officer who was running a small intelligence unit, and I went, I was not trained in intelligence at that time, and I went to Vienna, where I talked to a very, very nice major, army major. Both of them wanted me to join them, but I said I couldn't make up my mind yet. I had to go back and see what's going on in Nuremberg. In the meantime, the new director had been brought in, and he wanted me to work with him, and I decided to stay in Nuremberg. But on that occasion, I found my mother-in-law. She was around. She was still in her old apartment, and although the Red Cross director had his office in the next building, he had been unable to find her. We had tried to reach her through the Red Cross, and it just so happened they weren't able to find her, but I found her. No slur on the Red Cross. It was just one individual who, at that time, did not do it.
While you were working in the trials, did you have an opportunity to see any of the concentration camps?
No. Years later, I worked for a while in Dachau, just for a few days, and that was long after that time. It was in the 50s.
Did you ever attend the hearings just as a spectator?
Did I what?
Ever attend the hearings just as a spectator?
Oh, yes, quite often. In between tours as interpreter, yes, you wanted to keep track of what's going on, because you may have to interpret on that subject the next day. So very often when we were not in the interpreting booth, we got into the visitor's gallery.
Did you have a different impression of the proceedings from the spectator's seat?
Somewhat. We watched our colleagues, which we couldn't when we were sitting next to them. Sure.
Were you involved in the wrapping up of the trials?
Yes, in a sense, because by that time, in 1948, by that time I was acting director of the language division. And one of my jobs that I had was to phase out, which is a very interesting task. I had, at the height, the language division had about 300 to 310 people. I had an open wall in one of the rooms, and I put all the names on that wall, and their present contract, and when they would like to go home, so that people who, under normal circumstances, couldn't have been released earlier because of the phasing out, were given an opportunity to leave earlier, and we worked with everybody, interviewed everybody, and got the phase out done. I enjoyed it. It was an interesting job.
Were you involved with the denazification program?
No.
How long did you stay in the area after the trials?
Not at all. I left before the trials ended. On the 5th of August, 1948. And the trials lasted until early 1949. There was one trial still running. That was the Wilhelmstrasse process, it was called, the Foreign Office trial.
Where'd you go after Nuremberg?
Oh, the historical division, it wasn't called that anymore. It used to be the historical division, the Office Chief of Military History of the United States Army. One of these incredible coincidences, on the ship over to the States, we were sitting, there was an army transport, and we were sitting at the same table in the dining room with a captain. By that time, I was still a first lieutenant, with a captain and his wife, who were also going home, and they came from another place in Germany, where he had been in the historical division of the US Army Europe Command. And he told me that his office in Washington, in the Pentagon, had mountains of German material that had to be translated into English, studies of World War II that were written by German generals and German general staff officers that had been captured by our army and had been given the opportunity of writing about their experiences, and that had to be done into English. And would I be interested? I said, well, I'm going to try in Washington and see what I can find. He says, well, if you don't find the right thing, come to us and we put you back on active duty. To make the story short, there were a few opportunities, but they didn't sound so good. And I went back on active duty with the Army Office Chief Military History, worked for 3 years, became historical editor and whatnot. And they put out some, the government printing office put out some of the studies I worked on, and I still have copies of them. My tours in the Army were usually 3 years.
In 1950, a clemency board reviewed some of the Nuremberg sentences, resulting in some reductions of those sentences. What was your reaction to that?
Didn't know about it. That's very simple, didn't know about it. I was in Washington in something else, and I was busy translating those studies. We had moved out of the Pentagon, we were in the GAO building near Union Station. We had a lot of commuting to do. I was busy.
Tell me about your career since Nuremberg.
After historical division, I'll make it short. In 1951, I was very fortunate to be sent to Austria, United States Forces Austria headquarters in Salzburg, Austria, where I became what they called command interpreter. I was interpreter for anybody who needed it, from the commanding general down to the who negotiated things with the Austrian officials, down to the private who wanted to get married and needed somebody to go to the Austrian authorities with him. I had all kinds of interesting jobs in that time because, especially the third of I had three bosses. General Stafford Leroy Irving, who was there in the first year. As I said, my assignments were 3 years. General Hayes of World War I fame, and who was High Commissioner in Germany at one time, and General Arnold, William H. Arnold, not the Air Force Arnold, an Army Arnold. He was a wonderful guy. And he knew that I was born and raised in Austria, so whenever he got letters from the population for something which I translated, he would, after a while, he would say, get me Pete, and then he said, what do you know about this? So one day he got a letter from a convent, from the Mother Superior in a convent, where she wrote, would he make available an ambulance, not a bus, to take their nuns and their girls that went to the school to Rome. General sent me out to tell the Mother Superior we couldn't do that, so I went there and I explained to her, this is government property, that means property of the American people. We can use that when it's a question of life or limb, but we can't use it for this and that. And she smiled. She was very nice looking at that thing. She smiled and said, well, no harm in trying, is there? Just to describe some of the things that the interpreter had to do at that time. It was a three-year tour that was very, very nice and very rewarding. I interpreted for Secretary Acheson on one occasion when he came to Vienna, and I was sent down to Vienna. Interpreted for the High Commissioner, Thompson, and in a spy trial where I was the only interpreter. I had to do both, German, English, English, German. After that, at the end of my tour in Austria, it was suggested that I would be accepted for intelligence. I was 10 years a citizen by that time. That may have something to do with it. I was sent to the States, sent to Army Intelligence School for the basic course, then had an intelligence tour in Germany of 3.5 years, sent back to the U.S. Army Intelligence School and became an instructor, and from there was sent then to Laos and Vietnam, 2 years in Vietnam. That brings us up to 1964. Beginning of 65, when I was called in, I was 54 years old, and I was called in by my boss, who said that they want you to put in your papers for retirement. I didn't want, I would like to stay on. And so he said, I told him there is a war on, but still I had to put in my papers for retirement. I was sent to Washington. I had the final tour here in Washington in security, personnel security, etc. And in 1966, I was retired. I had a parade at Fort Myer and was retired and became a civilian. And a few months later, I got a job through the Government Employment Service. There was a U.S. Employment Service on K Street. I had gone there looking for a job. And they got me a job as translator and then chief of a translation section for Air Force headquarters as a civilian. I worked there for 8 years. Went to Germany in negotiations for a new aircraft, which was very interesting. The Germans never got to it because the British were faster. It was a V-stall, a vertical and short takeoff and landing aircraft. And the British were faster. They brought out the Harrier, which is that kind of a plane, so that German negotiation did not lead to anything. But I still had a lot of work to do in the Air Force. I finally retired from the Air Force as a civilian in 1974. That's a long time ago. I've been longer retired than I was working by now, for the Air Force anyway.
Tell me about what happened to your first wife.
She had had a hypertrophy of the thyroid, which is a very bad thing because it affects disposition, it makes people unhappy. To the point that sometimes when I came home, when we lived here, she was crying and she said, "Don't worry, it's not me, it's the doggone thyroid. I can't help it." She was treated, she was operated here in Alexandria in 51, and it got a little better, and we went overseas. The problem with an army wife is that it is so difficult, almost impossible for her to have a career. Because the husband gets transferred to some other place, she may or may not find the right kind of work there, or even work there, and that was very difficult for her. When I was working for the Air Force, she was better by that time, but then the thing developed into cancer, and that was the end. She died in 72.
Did you have any children? You remarried?
Yes.
How did you meet your second wife?
She was a friend of my first wife's for 22 years. When we were stationed in Salzburg, my wife worked in intelligence. She was in intelligence long before. She was more intelligent than I. She was there long before I got into it. And Anna's first husband, Victor Cooper, worked with my first wife in the same office. So they knew each other before I ever knew Anna. But we kept in touch, my wife kept in touch with her. And when my wife died, I got the most wonderful letter from Anna. Anna was stationed in North Carolina at that time with EPA. And she wrote me the most wonderful letter. So I went down to North Carolina according. And a year and a half later, we got married down there by Rabbi Stilpas, God rest his soul, very lovely man. She was very active at that time in the Jewish community. She sang in the temple. And we had very dear friends in the Jewish community, in the Reform community in Raleigh, North Carolina. The best was the Rosh HaKol, who was a woman, a lady, Nell Hirschberg, who was a good friend of ours.
Have you kept in touch with people that you knew at the trials?
Sprecher is actually the only one. And then recently, at the time of the reunion, you know, people all of a sudden came from different sides and I saw them again.
What do you think has been the biggest success of Nuremberg, the trials at Nuremberg?
Never again. It's in these two words. never again, the truth about what happened. It took a setting like that, and even that is not enough. It took a setting like that to persuade people that this really happened, and still you have revisionists to say it never happened. But the greatest there are two great functions of the Nuremberg trial. This is one of them, the truth. The other thing is for the Germans, that it protected the Germans, it saved the Germans from a judgment of collective guilt. Because the Nuremberg trial demonstrated, more than any other war crimes trial, who did what and who did not. So from a purely humane point of view, this is tremendously important to people other than the Jews themselves. But the most important thing is the never again.
What has been the biggest failure of the Nuremberg trials?
That they have not become common property of millions of people. That they're still not known. That there are still all kinds of stupid stories. I run into people who say the worst thing about the Nuremberg trials is that they were kept in secret. There's nothing more open than that. You could walk in, most people, unless they were Nazis running from the police. Even the Germans later on, not in the first trial, in the IMT trial, later on could walk into room 10 on the ground floor of the courthouse and identify themselves and ask for a courthouse pass. And if there was any room, they got the pass and they could sit in the courtroom. All kinds of people came in, not only movie stars.
What, to your mind, should be the lasting legacy of Nuremberg?
It could happen anywhere. It's dangerous. It could happen anywhere. If the right chemistry is available to bring it about. It has happened in Africa, in some countries. It could happen anywhere. We must recognize, and Nuremberg helps to do that, we must recognize what makes it, what does it. Nuremberg did not go into the prehistory as much as it should have. The prehistory was very simply that in the 19th century until 1871, there was no Germany. It was a patch quilt of principalities, little kingdoms, and whatnot. England was a nation. France was a nation. Sweden was a nation. Even little Denmark was a nation. Norway was a nation. Germany was not. And that left a lasting feeling of, it's no excuse, of inferiority. It was an inferiority. It came out of the Reformation, out of the, as you know, you're a historian. I don't have to tell you. But just in answer to your question, what made it goes much further than just the National Socialist Party. In that respect, the BBC man was right. There was something in the German nation, the German people, that brought this about.
You just made reference to the BBC man. Can you explain for the camera what you were talking about?
The BBC man was a guy who came here and made an interview with me, which resulted in a small spot or two in a BBC series. His name is... I'm very bad. My computer is slow, but it will produce it. Adam Curtis. And he had a series in the BBC, a small series on the Nuremberg trials.
Was there ever a time that you regretted being involved with the trials?
No. It was something that had to be done, and I was very, very glad and honored to be there to do my part in it.
What do you think is the legacy of the work that you did with the translations, the interpretations, rather? What's the legacy today?
I don't think there is any. I don't think it was that important. I just did the job that so many others did.
Did you follow the Eichmann trial in Jerusalem?
Not in any particular detail, no.
Did you have a sense of how it compared to what you experienced at Nuremberg?
it followed pretty much the example.
How has the experience of being a refugee impacted your life?
We don't have time to answer that. We don't have time to answer that. It made a complete change. I would be a completely different person. The question is, what are the alternatives? What would have been the alternatives? That's a very iffy question. Had I remained, had there been no Hitler? What is the question, you see?
Then let me ask you how your experiences at Nuremberg have impacted your life.
It took 50 years until people found out that I was in Nuremberg. And then all of a sudden, people came from various sites and said, there is an old coot, a living fossil, who was there. Let's find out what he can tell us. That's the only impact for 50 years or so. There was nothing, as far as I'm concerned.
Is there anything that we haven't discussed that you wanted to add?
No, thank you.
Can you tell me about the film, Justice at Nuremberg?
I think it was very good, only of course it was sort of hooped up. It was the play between the various artists. It was very well done. It was not quite like the Justice case, but it was shaped after the Justice case. And they did a very good job in representing the presiding judge. It's very well done.
We're going to pause now to change tape. Peter Uiberall, and I have one final question for you. What message do you have for the viewers of this tape?
If 100 years from now there are any people who are still interested in the Nuremberg trials, they should read what went on and should tell others about it. The most important thing about the Nuremberg trials is their content, not the fact that they happened, but their content. If anybody doubts that the Holocaust occurred and how it occurred, go to the Nuremberg trials. It's all in there.
Thank you. Can you introduce this lady to us, please?
This is my wife, Anna Uiberall. We are married almost 24 years. We are actually newlyweds, only 24 years.
Tell me who this is.
This is a picture of myself when I was about 6 years old in Styrian clothes in the village in Styria where we lived. That's where I went to school for second grade. My mother taught me first.
And the name of the person?
Ernest P. Uiberall. At that time, Uiberall, Ernst Uiberall.
And when was it taken?
That's difficult. It was about 1917 or 1918, probably 1917. you can do with a picture like this. Fabulous.
Tell me about this picture.
This is a picture of my family. My father, Jacob Uiberall, as a sergeant in the Austrian Imperial Army. My mother, my grandmother, and on the left, myself as a little boy. It was probably 1918.
Can you give me the names of your mother and your grandmother?
My mother's name is Auguste, or Auguste Uiberall. My grandmother, Jeanette Altmann. The little boy is Ernest Peter Uiberall.
And when was this taken?
I think 1918.
And where?
In a little village called Premstetten near Graz in Styria, which is a southern province of Austria.
Tell me about this.
This picture is from right to left. My father, Jakob Uiberall, my mother, Gusti Uiberall, my late first wife, Erna Uiberall, my brother, Paul Uiberall, and myself, then Ernst Uiberall.
And when was it taken?
I would guess it was in the winter of 1936 to 1937.
And where was it taken?
Don't know. Don't know. Somewhere on a trip in Austria.
What are we looking at here?
That's my courthouse pass that I used in Nuremberg during the time that I was there to get into the courthouse. It says Tribunal Pass on the top, and my name is on it. It's very difficult to read. It's signed Ernest P. Uiberall in the left lower.
What is this here that we're looking at?
To the best of my knowledge, there is a letter that Colonel D'Auster wrote, a letter of reference for me, where he described what I have been doing at the Nuremberg trials. Colonel D'Auster went from Nuremberg to the United Nations in April 1946, and before he left, he wrote me that letter.
Can you summarize the letter for me? Can you tell me, just briefly?
Oh, merely what I was doing, at what time I started as a monitor, when I became an interpreter, etc., and some flattering things, saying that I'm capable of handling people, etc., etc. In other words, a good recommendation, which was realized later on when I became acting director. Ain't that important, Beacon Drop?
What are we looking at now?
That is a letter from Judge James T. Brand, who was the presiding judge in the justice case. It came from the Supreme Court of the state of Oregon. He's written that letter from there. It's just a letter of commendation for the work I did in the justice trial. Doesn't mention that I didn't always translate literally. The professor.
What are we looking at here?
A letter from then Brigadier General Telford Taylor, now Professor Telford Taylor. Letter of commendation for work I did at the Nuremberg trials.
Tell me the significance of this.
That is a book put together by Hilary Gaskin, a British young historian who who came here and interviewed people, and also did in England, interviewed people who were at the Nuremberg trials, not as main actors, but as the Indians, so to say. She interviewed courtroom guards, she interviewed occasional visitors, she interviewed, for instance, the wife of the British chief prosecutor, who was there a lot, and she interviewed myself, me, Ernest Peter Uiberall, as interpreter at the Nuremberg trials.
Okay, we're going to open this up and show a photo from inside. But we opened up that book. Tell me about this picture.
This is part of Göring's testimony. Göring is sitting in the foreground in the witness box. And I was on duty on that day and interpreted Göring's testimony. I'm looking straight at Göring from the interpreter's booth because I've always found it important to try and see what the facial expression of the person speaking is at the time.
So can you identify yourself using words?
Peter Uiberall, interpreter at that time. Hermann Göring in the foreground, the right corner. The gentleman between us is the Marshal of the Court, Colonel Mays, M-A-Y-S.
Just for clarification, you are which person? Can you describe yourself in this picture?
On the right side with the hand over the microphone looking at Hermann Göring.
Can you explain this photo?
On the left, in front of the guards, you see the guards lined up on the wall, and in front of the guards are the defendants in two rows. The one in the front row closest to us is Hermann Göring at the corner. In front of the defendants are the defense counsel, German lawyers, and the one right in front of Göring is Kranzbühler, the Navy judge who was defense counsel for the two admirals that were on trial. As you can see, there were a lot of defense counsel and associate defense counsel and assistants. There were a lot more than twice, I would say, the number of the defendants. We're defense counsel.
And who are we looking at along the back wall there?
That's myself again, Peter Uiberall as monitor. And next to me on the left side is the French desk that is into French. And the French officer is Commandant Meyer, who did English into French, I think.
And who is on the other side of you with what looks like a white armband?
Oh, that's the Marshal of the Court, Colonel Mays.
Do you know when this was taken?
That is difficult to say. It was it's difficult to say because I was monitor, to be sure, until the time when I served as interpreter, and then later when I served as interpreter, alternating. I was also serving as monitor. It was taken in the beginning, in the early months, I would say, of 46, January, February, probably March.
And again, where was it taken?
At the main the big courtroom in Nuremberg, at the IMT trial.
Tell me about this photo.
When I served in Salzburg, Austria, at headquarters, United States Forces Austria, USFA, I was sometimes borrowed by the embassy, U.S. Embassy in Vienna, because they didn't have a permanent interpreter. This was at the time when Secretary Acheson, Secretary of State Acheson, visited Vienna in 1952, and I was sent down to Vienna to interpret. And that was at the airfield where he arrived. He made a speech, and I was kicked by the press officer and says, go to it, and ran forward and started interpreting, and interpreted his speech into German.
And your And your name again?
Peter Uiberall.
And which one of these two gentlemen is you?
On the right side, the secretary, Dean Acheson, on the left side.
Can you tell me about this photo?
That picture was taken at the United States Embassy in Vienna, and I was sent down to Vienna to interpret for the United States High Commissioner for Austria and Ambassador Llewellyn Thompson, who is in the middle. My name is Peter Uiberall, and I'm to the left of the High Commissioner. It was probably a press conference.
And when was this taken?
This was taken in 1953 or 1954, but I think it was 1953 when Llewellyn Thompson was High Commissioner in Vienna.
Thank you, and this concludes the interview today.